Oh, yeah. Oh, coffee. Oh. Oh, tomorrow. Tomorrow, I swear. Lucy, I'm home! I'm Jim Pollock, and I've been making art for over 20 years now. And I started out doing a few carvings, taking them to school in my pocket, calling them my pocket pieces. And a couple of teachers took notice and put me in a room and didn't let me out until I actually came up with something they liked. So I was real happy that that's where my start came from. That and watching my father carve when I was a kid. And I went from carving fairly large pieces of wood and switching over whenever my shed had burned down and had most of my artwork in there. I decided if somebody's going to burn me out of my livelihood, I'll make it out of metal from now on. Since I worked at a foundry and had access to a welder, I decided that this would be the place for me to switch over and the time to switch over and take care of making my type of folk art. So on this piece, I originally wanted to call it Hung Up because I was making clothes hanger type of hooks for the very top of the head. And I didn't mind that the head was so arbitrary as far as just being round, arbitrary as in dull, you know, because what I was looking for was more or less the line and kind of poking fun at line drawings to begin with is what I was really making a statement about was how this rebarb, which has been in the earth for quite a while, comes down into almost nothingness where it really reaches into the ground that's farthest and is just decayed away to nothing. So we have these tips that almost represent roots. Roots coming right out of the ground made out of metal instead of making out of natural materials like wood and grass. And so I started out with a line drawing 20 years ago and I finally got around to finally discovering what I wanted to do with this piece. And it was to make these fluid lines and to have this feeling of it almost floating or being on a stream and it's just washing down the stream, whatever this image was made out of. I wanted it to feel like it was on top of the water or in the air floating away and give it that sense of movement, of freedom. There's a few patches in here where it's not touched. And that kind of makes it nice also, because you got that transition. And wherever I've welded, it kind of matches, or I try to get it to match the texture of the piece. You know, especially in here. And there's a couple other ones I really like. This one's okay. This one stands out a bit, but I don't mind because this one really needed to be a structural weld compared to the rest of them. And this one stands out a little bit, but I'll be able to hit that with a wire brush and just gently tap it once again with the welder, and that'll disappear into that grayness. And I really love that grayness because it harkens back to the woods again, where the trees are all gray. And it took my father to make me realize that the trees were gray. He told me I had to go outside and look. And I had gone outside during the rain, after the rain had come, and I saw all the trees as brown, but after it dried up, they were all gray. Gray and green and a bunch of other colors, but mostly gray. You gotta put your signature on every piece, or you'll have every customer stop you and ask you, where is it? I wanna make sure it's on there. I don't wanna walk out of this place without it being on there. So I make it a policy that at the end of every piece, it gets hand signed. And I usually put my little upside down off, which is the moment of conception, the sperm breaking through the egg. Because I guess I'm a conceptual artist at heart, and I've been using that same symbol for a very long time so that people knew that this was my work.
Describe the pieces you had at Passion Fish.
The pieces at Passion Fish were some of my favorite art, and Sandy's favorite art. And Sandy Castle runs Passion Fish, and she does the perfect job of being someone in touch and out of touch in the same moment, and just letting things happen the way they should, and not worrying or stressing over small things. So I took her my best work, I thought. And the first piece I brought in was, we're still cutting each other down. And it was an SKS stock with sling blades on top and underneath for the magazine. And it had a figure cutting people down with a sling blade. Some were curious, some were running away, some were throwing up, but nobody was doing anything about the problem. And I was just demonstrating that one person could send a lot of people's lives into sheer terror. And the other pieces I had there, one I called Shacked Up, is it's basically a bird's nest or bird's cage. And it's got three shotgun barrels coming out of a very small opening, and you can't figure out where the rest of the shotgun is, because it's such a small opening that it almost looks like it's out of an old cartoon mayhem. And the third piece I had there was You Can't Yank My Chain, or Can't Yank My Chain. And it was a piece I made while I was walking along buying stuff in a flea market. And the piece basically was a spring-loaded chain that was going through a cavity. And the cavity was made from old Baltimore fencing. And it basically looked like the cavity of someone's insides, with a back end of an arrowhead, large arrowhead, stuck into what might be the heart area. And the chain went all the way through the box and dangled down to its broken end where the handle was missing. And that's the reason you couldn't yank the chain anymore and yank out the insides of who was in the box or who was the box.
Hi, I'm Donna Lynch Archer. I'm one of the curators here at Angel Falls Studios, a gallery at the corner of 30th Street and Remington Avenue in Baltimore. We are just over a year old. We have a 3,000 square foot gallery and a cafe. And one of our goals here has been to provide artists with a very comfortable space to exhibit their work. I think this is what they had in mind when they say one man's junk is another man's treasure. This piece called Sky Dancer by Jim Pollock is a perfect example of found object art. We have everything in here from old bicycle chains, blades, pieces of machinery, rusted metal. And it's just amazing to me when an artist can sit down and go through a pile of scrap and see this in it. I think that that's a gift in and of itself and a talent, and I have a great deal of respect for people that can do that, because it's very hard for me to see anything in a big heap of scrap metal other than a big heap of scrap metal. One of the things about Jim's work that I really like is that it looks dangerous. Many of the pieces I've seen by him have old rusted blades, very sharp edges, and definitely look as though you could hurt yourself on them. And I think it's really interesting in this show in particular, because we have another piece by Jim Pollock that couldn't be more different. It's very soft and very subtle. I met Jim Pollock over a year ago and had the good fortune to visit his home and see a lot of his work that he had there. We also had him in an exhibit when we first opened the gallery, and I really liked what he did with found object art. I think he really has a good eye for it. One of the things about this piece here that I really like, though, is that it's very different from what he usually does, or at least what I've seen. This is very delicate and very flowing, and I think it's a really interesting side of Jim and his work to see something so subtle come from somebody that usually does very large and imposing and weighty pieces.
Oh, Angel Falls. I thought it was a beautiful gallery. I still do. And it was perfect. I wanted to show three brand new pieces. It didn't quite work out that way. I managed to get one done, which is a huge Indian dancer I call Sky Dancer. And it got a really good reaction. And I couldn't have been happier for the reaction. I invited over 50 people, and when only 10 people showed up, I was about to throw a fit. As I figured, you know, I'd put in all this time. I even sent out pictures of the piece to people just to entice them to come along. And only 10 people showed up. Oh, it sticks in my craw. But that's okay. They had over 200 people that night, and it stayed up for a whole month. I like the U.S. Bombers piece that I did. Just the fact that those stars and the eyes, that's just, to me, it's just a really bad play on pop and popish type of artwork, you know. Punching someone in the head and they see stars, and here's a bomb about to explode onto someone. Of course, it's a male bomb because I made it into a male bomb, like giving it genitalia. And I like the roughness of the whole thing. I mean, there's cement splattered on it at some point, and the eyebrows that are bashed from the ends of wooden shovels. I really like that idea. And the mask, I finally, after 4 years, have started to do some of the work I'd promised myself for so long to get done. And one of them was to take a cover from a water main from New Orleans and make a mold. And while that mold had wax in it and the wax had cooled, I'd fold it over a plaster face and get a wonderful image. And I finally found the right plaster face to push it over, and it worked out beautifully. And I can't wait to start cranking those out. So we're going to talk about making that tree again, huh? And where we start out,
dragging that two-tiered thing around from the other side. You just can't bring it through the house anymore. It was nice when it was just one tier. It was only 3 foot.
Hello.
Nobody really paid attention to it, but they thought it was pretty weird. And we got all those hubcaps for free because we had that big storm in 96. It gave us a nice pothole so we could come by and just pick up hubcaps here and there. And you'd think by the second year it had gotten bigger because the tree had gotten a little bigger. But I just think that's an ego type of thing. I was thinking about sending it so high that the whole city would just have to condemn it and have to bring it down. And after seeing the joy on people's faces, I had to change my mind and just let them have what they wanted. So I've only gotten it up to 8 feet so far. As long as I can still reach the top and put my dinosaurs on, I'm happy. You know, but when we start out, we just have a simple frame, and then I'm wrapping it with bigger and bigger lights right on up to the top, so it has something to twinkle on the inside whenever I get done. And then we're hanging them constantly, trying to make sure that there's enough on one side that the other side doesn't fall over. That can be a problem sometimes. And some of that snow is a little heavy. I know because it bent last year's frame, so the whole thing looked like it was right out of the Grinch that stole Christmas with the whole tree tipping over. Which wasn't too bad for me, but I know other people were disappointed last year. I really need doorknobs. If you can find some old doorknobs, I'd really appreciate it. You know, we got cicadas coming up. I've been really good about getting these big ones. I really like these big ones, but I'm really running low on the small ones. They might be in another pile. I see a few small ones, but those are edge. Those are too small. I need some mediums. I got 2 mediums here.
Why do you need the small ones?
I need the medium small ones so I can make the middle of the creature, my snowman. I need to make lots of snowmen this year. I have a feeling it's going to be a really cold winter. And we should get some more kids' bikes. We should go find those. I need to find the medium rims. I got 3 medium rims. We need to go downstairs. We need to find the rest of the mediums. Let's go. Yes, I made a shelf for Mom. You know, not your typical shelf, but these are the kind I like. I never could get it to hang right though. I'm still trying to figure that one out. I like it to hang like that, so she could put her stuff on it. And be careful.
Is that how many bikes you have here in the basement?
Oh, Jesus. It's getting worse. I think I have enough to do 100 snow people. But I'm still missing, like the medium rims. I've got a few more here. There's got to be some more kids' bikes that we can go and find. You know, maybe you go out tonight. Maybe we'll find something to throw in there. You know, someone's back there. Yeah, I've got a rough count here. But I still think we need to get out there, you know, because that's where it is. It's out there.
Okay.
It's not in here. In here is just potential. Out there, that's where the fun stuff is.
Okay, let's go out there then.
All right.
What exactly is out there?
More bikes.
So why are we out in the alley now?
Guess we're gonna go get one. We might get a couple tonight. See, what I'm really doing
is I'm snagging little kids' bikes from the alleyways here in Hamden to make my stuff.
You're stealing bikes from Hamden?
Shh, don't tell any of the kids. They really fear me. You should see their faces at Christmas time. They hate my house, but the parents love it. You ready? Let's go. No, I wouldn't. No, we gotta get these to the house quick. Come on. I moved in here with my roommates, and my neighbor Sharon Burke came over and said, we're going to give you some lights, you just do what you want with them. And fresh out of college, we just put a big egg X up, and that was the first year that they hung those lights across, and it looked really nice. It was nice. And I moved out soon after that and came back a couple years later and bought the place. And when I first moved in, it was December 31st of 93. And of course I didn't have any time to decorate, and it was the very last day anyway. But it was still nice to know that that magic was gonna come around one more time in the month of December, and I had to get ready in that first year. I made snowflakes and had to put out a big bright spotlight so that it could people could actually see the snowflakes on the wall. And the next year I decided, well, I think I better do something a little different, so I grabbed some rims out of the alleyways that were off of bad bikes and found a couple of tricycles for sale and started making snow people. And my neighbor Diane liked it so much, she said, what do you want to trade for those snow people? And at the time I had a cat, and I traded her cat food, cases of cat food, for snowmen, which really came in handy. And then these snowmen sort of evolved because my other neighbors liked them next door to me, and I started selling them a couple. And then people from the neighborhood that would come down to see the lights would ask if they were for sale. So I've done well over 100, and they're out there in the public somewhere. And I can just imagine that there's a few sitting behind someone's shed, rusting away, going back to the earth, you know, right where I found them from in the first place. Of course, we already have enough material on the earth to last us a while. So when they try to throw things away, I kind of grab them before we hit the trash permanently. See if I can't get something happening. You know? Oops,
I get to look at this wrench every day. And I've looked at it for the past week and thought, you know, this is the week I get to cut it. I was never so happy. I finally get to cut this wrench up. I keep thinking about it and thinking about it, not getting it done.
How those little lines get into your tabletop there, I see.
Yep. We'll take them over and do a little grinding. These are all the pieces I've gathered. These are the things I'm hoping to make one more accordion player out of. And I'm not sure how it's all going to go just yet. I mean, it's basic. You got your upper torso right here.
What is that made out of?
Now this was an old pulley. And I've cut the top circle off of the pulley to put a head on it. Got that head right here. This old piece of metal. And I'll add the face to this old piece of metal. But what I'm going to do next is try and figure out how to incorporate this shape right here into this so that I can lengthen the body. So I kind of want the body to go down a little bit farther so it's a longer figure. I don't mind if it's a short figure, and people like that, but I feel like they get more out of it if the figure was a little bit longer. And had a little more pizzazz to it, you know.
I noticed you've got some chains here.
Yes, I got all sorts of chains.
Different types of chains.
Yeah. Now, this is some of my favorite chain right here. And I'm not sure how to use it just yet, but we might give this a shot. It is nice when these are real rusty. They actually keep their shape. And you can bend them. And they'll stay in place. That's not true all the time. He's a little high up, isn't he? He looks happy, though. It's kind of hard to tell what he's playing. But I don't mind. He looks happy. That's all that matters. But this is my series of minstrel players. This one's playing the accordion. I had a lot of them playing banjo, because I love the banjo. And a few of them playing guitar. Those are the ones I really miss. The guys that want to buy the ones that are playing guitar. Ah, I love those things. It's hard to find a good guitar. But they're out there. I think Chain worked okay in this. I like it. It gives it sort of that pirate feel. I really like the fact that the head moves. I like this pose better than any of them, of course. I've got to straighten up the tip just a little bit. I'm going to take some sanding disc and hit it real quick. And the feet, they look, looks like he's enjoying himself. Now the feet could come down like this. We could have him out like this. And he could be all prim and proper. Or we can move him back to this station. Have his head tilt just a little bit, and he's ready to run the world. Probably look something along those lines when we get done. This is one of my favorite pieces that never sells.
should probably take it down so that nobody buys it and I don't cry in front of them. Not that one. Reminds me too much of my childhood. All right. Got one over there, got one over there. Got to put a bronze over here. Oh, it's a piece I call cut. It's supposed to be remembering elephants. There's six elephants in there. There's the tail. There's the footprint. Nails. Yeah, this kind of works. It'll work in a minute or two. Oh my God, sweet potatoes. I'm just like it's made for it. All right, they'll look good, huh? All those people at Christmas time. We have to set up a little bit early, start in November, and clear out everything in the pizza boxes and the beer cans and clean the place up a bit and start painting. And then we'll start dragging in one piece at a time and getting anxious waiting for that opening day whenever they light the whole entire street. It's always nice to have Thanksgiving off because right after Thanksgiving, you know it's going to get busy.
Tell me about Jeff's, who also shows with you. Why do you let other artists show with you?
Well, there's been as many as five artists showing at one time in here. And I've always been really happy with that. Because the more people that you have in a small space, the more people will appreciate what you're doing. Because you're giving everyone a chance. But this year, we scaled back to just Jeff and I. Because we're starting to get larger egos, I think. Because our pieces are getting bigger. I tease Jeff about that a lot. Saying that, you know, one day that there'll only be enough room in here for two of our pieces and our two heads and maybe one more person walking in. And that'll be it. But right now, Jeff's done a wonderful job of starting to put up his new display. And I can't wait to see it finished. And we'll have another 10,000 people walk through that door in 20 days, and I can't wait. And then at the end of it, I can't wait for it to be over, that's for sure. It's a lot of people coming. Are you going to be smiling and nice till 11 o'clock at night? Not every night you want to be that way. Always helps to have a few belts before they come in.
Well, 7 years ago, Jim came to me with an idea he had, turning his front room into a gallery, taking advantage of all the crowds that appear here every year to see the Christmas lights. I figured it was a beautiful opportunity to show the artwork off to some people, see what kind of response we'd get from the public since we worked all year on our stuff. And this is the first year I've done anything like this. And this year I had a vision of doing a large piece that would really overwhelm the public and make them stop and go, wow, how about that? And this is my effort. I hope I succeeded. This is 16-gauge tie wire. Used to tie rebar together and casting concrete. And it's very strong, easily flexible, but it won't break too easily. So it's good for bending and twisting, and it holds its shape. It's really quite strong for its size. And I first started getting into the wire, I was visioning it as a pencil line or a pin line as I was bringing it out, trying to make it flow, and they grew into these constructive drawings that I've become obsessed with lately.
Have fun. I'll see you later.
Okay, bro.
Take it easy, man.
Turn them off. Let's drag in.
So we got it all done.
So what now?
We wait.
For what?
We wait for a few more people to walk through and say hello to. Happy holidays.
How you doing? Happy holidays.
How you doing? Happy holidays. It was important to me to do these displays because it brings thousands and thousands of people to my front door. And as an artist, and I wanted to be a grassroots artist and start there and work my way up, and to be able to meet the public, and all the public. Not everyone goes to museums, and fewer people go to galleries to discover what art is. It's always nice to go to an opening. It's always nice to have friends who are artists and go to their openings. But it's even nicer when people just kind of discover who you are all on their own without you forcing them to. I don't force anyone to come through my front door. If they have it in them, I put out a sign, they're welcome to come by and say hello and check things out. And then you get to be what you want, which is inclusive with everyone. And we were talking earlier about how much harder it is to get along with people instead of just getting along with people. And the fact that some of my stuff is definitely anti-war, because we can't figure out how to get along. I think if you just live your day by day, strive to do better, it gets easier. The older I get, the more accepting I am. I guess that has to do with not worrying about traditions, certain traditions. Oh my goodness, that was a bone. Oh, that was a big bone. Maybe it was a piece of onion. Yeah, it's probably onion. Now that I think about it, it's got onion stuff in it, onion mix. I thank God for beautiful weather and a wonderful day. And
and that beautiful weather means I get to cook again. It's always nice to cook indoors when it's freezing cold outside, but it's even nicer to cook outside, no matter what the weather.
I like that mushroom. We're right here in wonderful Waldorf, Maryland, and this is St. Charles, where I grew up, and this is the family homestead where I spent many a wonderful year playing in the backyard, cutting grass for the neighbors. It's grown up quite a bit since I was a kid. It was nice when Dad was looking at the plot of land. He decided that that one with a big wedge, we'll take that one. And it just happened to be 19 Pagnell, and most acreages around here are about 3/4 or a quarter, and his is a good 3/4. So we had a little forest in the back to play with.
What are we looking at here, Jim?
Well, this is the shed I used to have. When I got out of college, my father generously put up a shed to hold my artwork in until I found the right place. And the same year that I bought my house, I should have come down and gotten all my stuff out the moment I bought my house. Because within a few months of buying my house, some kids in the middle of the night burned down the shed because they couldn't find anything of value. So a lot of my old artwork is now permanently welded together by flames. This is some of the cherry wood my father brought to me up in college as I was carving a lot of wood when I was in college and I was just starting to switch over to mixed media. But after getting burned out, I decided if wood's that easy to burn, I'll switch over to making metal sculpture. And the next time they burn me out, I'll be able to pick it up out of the ashes and keep on getting up. The wood's over here. Didn't exist when I was a kid. When I was a kid, all that was sandy beach on the other side. There's a creek over here. And whenever I'm in my dreams, I still see that sandy beach. And that's the separation between reality and my subconscious mind is jumping that creek in my dreams. So this creek back here played a major role in my life, apparently, because it's something I dream about pretty constantly. But these are the creeks that we played in and jumped over and found veins of clay to make clay sculptures out of. And every once in a while I still come back and I still dig in this muck and find an old piece of steel from long ago that I remember someone throwing in and take it home. And I've made art out of it, and I've made people's gates for the inside of their house out of some of the stuff that I've literally ripped up out of this wonderful old creek.
Hi, my name's James W. Pollock, Sr. I'm James W. Pollock, Jr.'s dad, believe it or not. Jimmy grew up right here from the age of 6 on. And he did a lot of that artwork he's working on now while he was living here.
Do you think being out in nature may have led to his carving?
Oh yeah, I really do. I really do. You can see that in the work he does. Even today, you can see it in the work he does today. Because that's where he'll go. He'll go back to nature to say, look, I can take this old piece of rusty junk here and put it together so you can look at it and see, yeah, that really does look like a praying mantis or an armadillo or whatever he's making at the time. And he can take a look at that junk laying there and form something in his mind and know what it would take to put it together and come up with something that really looks good. People do enjoy his work. which is also great for him because he needs that reinforcement and it really helps him. Sometimes he gets down in the dumps behind where what he's chosen to do. So, but that helps when somebody looks at him and appreciates it.
So what do you think when his shed burned down, how did that transform him?
Oh, well, that was a tragedy in his life, really. Boy, that was a tough trip. We went down and it was all flooded out. We went down to West Virginia for, you know, a week or so, and we came back, the shed had been burned down. And all of Jimmy's artwork was in there. An awful lot of it was in there. And naturally, it just went up in smoke with the... Well, boy, what a mess all that was before we got done with it.
So where did carving begin for Jim?
Well, actually, it probably began when he was in his middle school age, and we were actually on a trip somewhere, and we were in a trinket store, whatever you want to call it, and they had a nice price on a Fairly Midland pocket knife. And so I let Jimmy buy one. Well, his mother got upset behind that like you wouldn't believe. And there was a lot of arguments about why he's too young to have the knife. He can't be carrying it around and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But I kind of pushed it, and Jimmy got to keep his knife, and Jimmy helped me out there. He promptly proceeded to carve on things and cut himself 3 or 4 good times, and now I'm going to lose this argument because Mama don't like all this blood coming out of him. But we worked our way through that. But at any rate, that was when he really started carving on things. He did with that pocket knife and little piece of wood, he'd go right to town.
It says wine, but I'm not really sure. I just know that it's leaking at this point. I don't know why it's leaking. But, this is the right type of stuff. This is what I need to put back in the altar. It's a little wine. Especially this kind of wine. This is West Virginia. Good brew.
Okay. So what is this little altar you have above your steps as you go down?
Well, this is my altar to dust and rust. As you can see, we're winning the war. And it just needs a little new fresh wine to go with it. This is everything of mine and yours and other people's that have collected here for a little while. And sooner or later, all this stuff will go away. But for right now, we just need to find places for everything. I've got my brother here. And some of the better hardware you could find for cutting. I think we should give that to someone this week. And of course you have to have all your symbols apiece. Or it all goes wrong again.
That's a pretty big Alf collection.
It's like I've nailed id to the wall. It's its own personal being that we got to be Alf every day. Not that I particularly like munching on cats, but I don't mind. Well, I started last week working on this part of the wing, and I finally got it done, and this week we're going to finish up the second half and do a little bending and a little cutting, and finally just the rest of the welding that needs done. And I'm down to measuring up my last few pieces. I'd already made a template, but we burned through it, so I'm just going to go off the other one to have an exact copy.
Now, what's the wing made out of?
This is old Baltimore fencing. rebarb, and one of my favorite things to use, which is the front and the headboard and footboard of old metal bed frames. I love old metal bed frames. They have lots of character, and they add a nice patina to a piece because of the different colors and the rust.
What's in the bottle?
Well, we got a couple of cicada and a couple other bugs that are pretty interesting. Some really large eyes, it looks like. But it's a cicada we're after today. This is my friend Wendy's collection. She keeps, I guess it's to scare off some of the scarier customers. Keep them at bay.
And what's the purpose of the cicadas?
Oh, well, this is what we're going to make our piece out of, and This is my model, as it were. I want to make sure that I capture all the details of each individual one, right down to putting back some hair. I've actually got some small springs to put back the hair on some of these feet, which I'm really happy about today. And those eyes are beautiful. These are bug-eyed. These were supposedly red when they were brand new. Of course, they turn jet black now because he's dead. I couldn't find the right color, red. So I went and got some Tutti Frutti nail polish. And it was the perfect color that I was looking for, which is this combination of red I painted underneath and the Tutti Frutti on top.
And what did you paint that
onto? This is one of the doorknobs from my house. I'm running out of doorknobs, so pretty much the doors are going to have to come off their hinges soon. I'll need to get into those rooms later on, and we can't have, you know.
So you're using the doors from your house to create your art?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I use everything. The fencing came from my backyard that I used for the wings, and other pieces came from the house. And it's, you know, and the house isn't really disappearing. It's just reforming. That's the way I like to see it. I bet your contractors would be saying something other than that. And those are the people I fear the most. Here we go. Thank you. Well, we're finally down to the body. And I really enjoy rust. So whenever I'm on the Potomac River or just in someone's backyard, I'll look for a 55-gallon drum. These are in nice shape. The ones that are on the river, they're not in such a nice shape, but they have nice texture. And I use these for all sorts of things. One of my favorites is bugs, different types of bugs. And we're using this one for the cicada today. And we're gonna close out our cicada by putting these two half barrels together and creating that cone shape, seeing how close we can get. I really like this edge type stuff. But I save that for later on. For right now, I think I'm gonna cut two straight pieces and start bending, see if we can't get a head going on. So let me start cutting. About hanging it up, even it hung up for a few days. Let's find out how much it weighs first. Finally, we got a giant cicada.
Why did you decide to make this thing?
Oh, 17 year cicada finally came up. And I was here in Baltimore the last time it came up. Which reminds me, I've been here for 17 years. And I figured it'd be nice to revisit it after they had all left. All the cicadas are gone now. All back in the ground. Millions and millions. I think the wings worked out really well. Which makes you want to celebrate all over again, doesn't it? This is Southern Maryland's finest flea market, called the Amish Flea Market. It's been here for 60 years or more. This is one of my other favorite places to find junk. Come on along for the ride.
Hello there. Howdy. How are you?
Pretty good?
I'm good.
You up for an interview?
Are you kidding?
I'm not. Ah. Well, we're right here at the White Elephant in wonderful St. Mary's County. And this is my good friend Claire, who owns the White Elephant. And she's been selling me things for now on 10 years. Some of the best junk I've made art out of has come out of this wonderful place. So we're just here searching around again.
We've got a couple of old rat tail wrenches now, too. Do you know what I'm talking about?
What's a rat tail wrench?
Okay. I mean, see, this one has the thick handle come down this
okay,
way.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
It comes down like a rat tail file and a real fine metal.
Okay.
Comes down. I noticed those yesterday. They were part of it. And that's an old tractor wrench. Isn't that cool the way it's done with the square?
Yeah, it is. That is nice.
You never see them with square. Yeah.
No, you don't. And you got another rare one over. Yeah. Over there on that corner, that's part of an old tractor,
yeah.
I noticed.
I love these old tools.
Well, that's what I come down here for, is find those beautiful old tools. I'll tell you, some of that one horse bit one day.
Yeah.
And we both should be biting our tongues because it turned out to be U.S. Union. Yeah. Union.
Oh, was Calvary. It Calvary?
Calvary,
yeah.
Union. And I cut it up to make art out of. Let me tell you, some people tell me, don't ever tell that story, Jim, that you ever cut that up, because they go for like 250 now.
Yeah.
And I wanna cry, but you know, I don't wanna cry that bad. Oh man, I better make something worth the darn to get my money. This is the type of thing I'm looking for. This old metal, it's hand forged. It already looks like a set of horns right here. And you can see where it's twisted from when I heated it up in the fire and twisted it. So this is beautiful. This is beautiful work. And this is the type of thing that, you know, this could be a set of legs, or this could be someone's hands up in the air praying. You know? So these are the types of items I look for. And we're down here in Southern Maryland at the Reuse Barn. This is one of my favorite places to come to pick up all sorts of wonderful rusty items, bicycles, bicycle chains, and some household goods.
I'm Ellen Hallmeyer. I'm co-chairman of this Reuse Barn project. We've been here 7 years now. What we're doing is helping the community. By that, we're keeping things out of our landfill, and of course, saving our natural resources. You were just in a building that's 20 by 60. That's our 30 by 60. That's our newest building, which keeps us out of the heat. Behind us is an old tobacco barn. This was on the property. That's what we started with. To the left of it was a tobacco stripping room. And that houses china, glassware, crafts, you name it. We're really excited when Jim comes down because he has a real eye for the oddities, and he's into our boxes and bins and into the dumpsters, and it's interesting to see what he comes up with.
Those bridles will work out real well. Those are for the horses. I'm excited. These are some of the best horse bits I've found in a while. This is great. This is exactly what I'm looking for to make my art out of. It's got nice pitted rust on it. Right age. Oh, these things will go so well with some of my banjo players and other sculptures. And I don't even know what I'm going to do with this. Probably a mask of some kind. This is great. This is definitely a reason I come down to Southern Maryland. Well, they haven't taken the fishing rods yet. And I use just the reel to go with my snowmen that are fishing in those snowflakes. I'm about to come back here and get these.
Golf clubs. Bowling balls.
Ooh, ottomans. You can use those out in West Virginia to sit around the fire.
Free dumpster, man. Free dumpster.
Man, no telling what it is. Man, this is great. Nothing like having your own dumpster to go play in.
Man.
Check these pie plates out, man. These are the best. Absolutely the best. I'll rust them. It'll be great for the backgrounds in my pieces. Lawn darts. They don't even make these things anymore. These things are so illegal, it's pitiful. Too many kids have gotten hit in the eye with them. I plan on making giant lawn darts one day. I better take these just in case.
So everything in the dumpster's free?
Yeah.
So you can just get in there and get whatever you want?
Anytime, yes.
Look at the hubcap Christmas tree and the bicycle
snowman.
Dad, crab?
Dad!
What?
That's my bike!
Honey, that's not your bike. That's art!
Dad, that's not art! That's my bike!